half. So I'm not going to talk too loudly. Hopefully the microphone makes me audible in the back. Is it okay? Yeah, let's get it right. But I don't want to do it by speaking loudly, otherwise I'll die. You still can't hear me? Can you turn it up more? Yeah, sorry about this, but I am afraid if I try and talk loudly, I won't talk very long. All right. So what I want to talk about today is rheology. If you type that into Microsoft Word, it will give you a spelling error and suggest theology. But there's no religion here, it's just science, all right? It's rheology, which is the study of how things flow, all right? And so the thing that makes rheology interesting for soft matter is that the materials we deal with are in general viscoelastic. And it means just what it sounds like. There are elements to the rheology of soft materials that are viscous and elements that are elastic, and the same material can display both behaviors at the same time. And so it makes the study of their flow more complicated and also more interesting. So you don't hear people talking about the rheology of hard materials, and that's largely because it's actually fairly simple and not that interesting, all right? But for soft materials, it's very interesting. So I want to give you sort of just some background to get you a little bit of intuition about how soft materials can behave and what the different types of behavior are. So suppose we have a plate and we load it up with some material in between. We have another plate on top here. We're going to attach a string to this. Maybe have a little pulley here. Have a mass. And at time t equals zero, we're going to let go of the mass. All right? So t equals zero, let mass pull. At t equals t naught, cut string. All right? Snip the string. So what we're going to do is apply a force down here for a time t naught. And what we want to see is what the response of the material is. So this top plate is going to move to the right. So I might, just to set that up, show how we'll do it. So let's see, I've called this distance h. And I call this distance here that it's moved s of t. All right, so that's just the distance. So the strain, as we talked about a few lectures ago, is how far it moves, say, in the x direction divided by what this gap here is. So in this case, the strain will be a function of time, and it will be s of t over h. All right. The strain rate, gamma dot, is 1 over h ds dt. In other words, it's the velocity of the top plate. Okay. So that's our protocol. So what I want to do is just show you sort of generically how a sort of normal material might behave or does behave, and how something like a polymeric gel will behave. So if we plot the strain as a function of time for a normal elastic material, and we're going to call this T0 and this 0. So at time 0, we start the force. And very quickly, it jumps up to some strain and then just stays constant out to T0. So I'm pulling on this stuff. It's elastic material. You think of it as a spring. I pull on it, and it immediately responds and moves until the elastic force matches the force that you have acting down there. As soon as you let go, as soon as you cut the rope, it springs back to where it was in the beginning. So it's perfectly elastic. All right, so that's a normal elastic material. All right, so how does a polymer gel differ from that? So again, we do the same thing, and what you might see is you might see it immediately jump up to some strain. That'll be its elastic response. So it is elastic, all right? And then, however, in contrast to what happens up here, is it will tend to creep up slowly a little bit more. All right, like that. And then when you cut the string, it will, in general, have an elastic response. It will recover, but it won't recover all the way. And that will be followed by some elastic relaxation. And it might not go back to its original position. All right? So this part of it, where it jumps up and where it jumps back, is an elastic response. All right, so it has an elastic response, but as you keep holding it there, you find that it drifts a little bit. It keeps on moving, as though, and this part we would call more of a viscous response. Although what people usually call this is creep, for obvious reasons. And then when you let go, it springs back. And then there might be a little bit more relaxation that'll occur over some period of time. All right, so that's how it responds to that. So the other thing I want to look at is an ideal viscous fluid. All right, so we're talking about something like water here. All right, so there you apply, when you start applying the force here, this top plate starts moving, and it moves with a constant velocity. All right, so what you'll see is you'll see it just start moving, and it keeps on moving up till it reaches, till you cut the rope. And when you cut the rope, it just stays there. All right, so that's how a fluid behaves. All right, simple enough. So in this case, actually, I should have said over here, we would say that the stress, all right, and the stress is simply this force divided by the area of that plate. All right, up here we would say that the stress is equal to an elastic, the shear modulus G, times gamma. So how far it displaces here depends upon what G is. All right. Okay, so obviously for a small G, gamma will be big for a constant stress. Over here, all right, so this, by the way, this is, we just call a constitutive relation. All right, so this is a constitutive relation for an ideal elastic solid. For an ideal fluid, by the way, we usually call fluids like this, like water, we call them Newtonian fluids. And here, the stress is proportional to not the strain, but the rate of strain. It's proportional to the slope and the proportionality constant is the viscosity, eta. All right, now, if you do this for a viscoelastic fluid, there's actually quite a huge variety of things you can see. But typically what you might see is something that looks like this. It starts going up, and then maybe it slows down. And then when you let go here, it might go like that again. All right, something like that. People like to make little mechanical models from springs and dashpots. And they write down equations for them, they solve them. I'll do it too, but I'm not going to solve the equations because the equations are too simple, they don't really work. But they do give you a sort of a physical sense of what is involved. So for this one, you might have something like this. So we'll have a spring attached to a table. Then up here, we have two things. We have another spring. And we have a dash pot. All right, and so we pull here with a force. This is our stress. And you might try and think about what happens. If I don't have this part up here, if I don't have this part up here, if I just have the spring, that's your ideal elastic solid. And I pull on that, the spring stretches, and it stretches out to some finite distance, and when I let go, it comes back to where it originally was. All right, so that's your ideal elastic solid. With a dashpot, what you're imagining here is this is like a piston in a viscous liquid. All right, so here you have to think a little bit. If I pull on this really hard, very quickly, think about it this way. Suppose I have a cylinder here sitting on the table, and I have a piston in it, and underneath the piston I have the piston immersed in some oil. All right. Now, what happens if I grab that onto the shaft coming out of the piston and I lift it up real quickly? If I do that, the whole piston and the cylinder will come up with me. All right, if I pull it fast enough. But then when I hold it there, the weight of the cylinder will start to drop as the fluid flows around space between the piston and the cylinder. All right, so it's important to have that piece of intuition. So when I do an instantaneous pull on it like that, or an instantaneous strain, it doesn't respond at all. All right, responds later. So what happens here, where you have this piston in a parallel with the spring, is just that. If I pull on this really fast, what happens is this is going to stretch and nothing's going to happen up here. But then as I hold that stretch, all right, I hold it here, this spring is pulling down like gravity. It's opposed by this spring, but it's also opposed by this. And this thing will start sinking down. So this one will stretch a little bit. the point is then this thing will stretch a little bit more. So that's this part of it here. All right, come over here. Now, when I let go of this, this spring will contract immediately. That's the elastic part. This one won't, because I have this viscous fluid here. So it'll just sit there. But during this period, this spring stretched. So after I let go, this spring will start pulling on this and it will start pulling this back down. And that's that part there. All right. But it doesn't recover fully because of that. Okay, so that's sort of the idea of how this works physically. If you want to do this one over here, it's sort of the same thing, except, you replace the bottom spring by a dash pop. Then you do the same sort of arrangement. So when you pull on this hard, nothing happens initially. It stays still, all right? But then it starts easing its way up. First here, this one will go, all right? This one will oppose that one going, all right? But then as it comes up, this one will come into action, all right? And you'll get this kind of behavior. When you let go, this one won't move anymore, but I will have stretched the spring, all right, and the spring will want to contract, and so that's the contraction there. All right, so these are sort of just mechanical ways of picturing what sort of thing is going on. Now, microscopically, it's not quite so simple, and one thing, you can write down differential equations for this, and you can solve them, and not too surprisingly, with simple models like this, all of these relaxations are exponential, with exponential rise and exponential decay with one characteristic time. One way in which polymeric materials, for example, and soft materials in general are more complicated is they seldom exhibit a single exponential relaxation like this. It's almost always more complicated than that. And there are some models, for example, where you get an infinite series of responses starting with some large relaxation time and then a series of faster relaxation times. And so these relaxation curves are considerably more complicated, and these models really sort of run out of gas, and they're not so useful. But in just getting some intuition about what's going on, this is pretty good, and what we want to do, of course, is understand what the microscopic, even molecular mechanisms are in soft materials that's behind this kind of behavior. Okay, so set that down. We defined the shear modulus by this. We defined the shear viscosity by this equation. Earlier this week, we defined also the bulk modulus by this equation. If you apply an isotropic stress, that is a pressure to a material, then you can define this bulk modulus as delta V over V. The minus sign is here because for a positive pressure, the change in volume is negative, and so this gives you a positive. So this is the shear modulus. This is viscosity. And this is the bulk modulus. You can also define Young's modulus And that you can define by say you have a cube and you pull on it with a uniaxial stress. That is, you pull on it with a stress per unit area this way. What will happen is it'll get longer, and in general, it will get skinnier. All right, so if this one, if the original one, say, has sides of length 1, then you'd say here this has this stretches to length lambda. And then in the x and y directions, they shrink. Here it expands, so lambda is greater than 1. Here they contract, and if you imagine that volume is conserved, all right, it's not necessarily, but it's not a bad approximation for small stresses, then each side here would have to shrink to 1 over the square root of lambda, so that 1 over the square root of lambda squared for the two sides times lambda would give you 1. You still have unit volume. So we define lambda as essentially LZ prime over LZ. We write this way. The stress is equal to Young's modulus, which we write as E times epsilon. Epsilon is the elongational strain, and epsilon here would be defined then as lambda minus 1. All right, so that's the amount you've stretched it. We can, for soft materials, all right, it turns out that soft materials are pretty close to being incompressible. Usually that's because they're essentially a liquid, all right, and most liquids are dense enough to be incompressible. So the bulk modulus doesn't differ from the bulk modulus of soft materials isn't so different from the bulk modulus of hard materials. They're both of the same order of magnitude. However, the shear modulus is a lot less. And you can actually, I'm not going to do it here because it takes us too far afield, but you can actually show that the Young's modulus is related to the bulk modulus and the shear modulus. Since it's a combination of the two, you can show that it's equal to 9 kg over 3k plus g. The reason I say that is in the limit that k is very large, you can ignore this term, and then the k's cancel out, and this goes to, for k much larger than g, this goes to 3g. All right, so it's generally true that Young's modulus in soft materials is approximately 3 times the shear modulus. That works rather well. So this is something you can prove from elasticity theory. It's not too hard, but it takes a while to develop. So I'll just it's just to alert you to this, so you know how these things work. Now. So what I want to do is to begin to develop some sense of the microscopic origin of elasticity, and we'll do that in today's lecture. And then on Saturday, which is my last lecture, we'll look at the microscopic origin of the very, very high viscosity of polymer melts and polymer solutions, and also then talk about their viscoelastic behavior. All right, so that's the plan. But the elastic behavior for virtually all polymeric materials that are either liquid or that are in some sort of liquid form, like a polymer melt or a polymer solution, has the same origin. And so that's what we're going to deal with today. So I'm going to erase this just because I want room. So so what we're going to do in talking about elasticity is we're going to use a particular model of a polymer. It's the simplest one you can use, but it gets all the essential physics. It's called the freely jointed chain, all right? And the way it works in its simplest version is you assume that you have N segments . These are, by the way, straight, perfectly straight. That are connected by hinges that allow the segments to adopt any orientation with respect to each other. So let me start here. Let's say this is my first, the end of my first segment. It goes out to here, and I'm going to call the length of each segment B. And then at this point, what I imagine is I have another segment, and we say that it can orient any way it pleases. In other words, there's no correlation between the way this segment is oriented and the next one. So the next one might go like this. It's also of length B. And so you go so on and so forth with this. Like this. So each of these is of length B, but the orientations are random. So what it is it's basically a random walk, which I believe you've studied in some of the other lectures here. All right, so this is the nth segment. This is the first segment. And then this distance we call vector r, and it's the end-to-end length. Now, one thing you can do very easily in this model is calculate what the mean squared end-to-end length is. So if I want to, if I look at this, R is obviously the sum from n equals 1 to capital N of the B sub n vectors. All right? So if I want to calculate, I just get a sum over N, sum over m of b sub n dot b sub m. All right. And so the obvious thing in this case, because these things aren't correlated with each other, when you go to do the average, so you do the average of each of these pairs, this is going to give you zero if n doesn't equal m. All right. So you only get the terms where n equals to m. There are n of those. And so this is just equal to n times b squared. All right. So so you can say if you define r as a square of r square of the average of r squared, that scales like the square root of n times b. All right. Now, if you want to make connection with microscopic molecular polymers, you have to be a little bit careful here. So you might take something like polyethylene, and the bond length, I forget what it is, but it's something like, I don't know, 1.5 or maybe two angstroms, on that order. The thing there is you'll have one segment between one polyethylene molecule and the next, and then the next one actually goes out at a particular angle, all right, just dictated by the molecular shape of polyethylene. But it has some freedom. It can rotate around like this in several positions, usually not an infinite number, usually something like three or four, something like that. But the point is, because of that, I walk this way, then maybe I shoot out this way, then the next time I shoot out that way, and the next time maybe this way. After several steps, after several molecular links, the direction in which a molecular bond is pointed is no longer correlated with a bond maybe five or six monomers before. All right. So there's two things you can do. The right thing to do, all right, is to actually model that. And we have various models for this. If the angles are really small, you can use a worm-like chain. If the angles aren't so small, you can use a fairly simple modification of this one. And then what happens is, if you have, for example, if this is a well-defined angle theta here between the individual bonds, then you can show that what goes here is not n, but n times 1 plus cosine theta over 1 minus cosine theta. All right? So if theta is small, all right, then this is going to be a number close to 0. This will be a number close to 2. And so the ratio might be 5 or 10 or something like that. But you'll get this same relationship. That is, you'll still get r squared equals this times b squared. All right? So that case, this becomes your new n. All right? Your n is less than you thought, and your b is longer. It's the b that's associated with this. So so the point is that while this is the freely jointed chain is a very simple model, it actually has wide applicability. It doesn't miss very much. And you can usually, by a rescaling of the problem, get back to where you want to be. The thing you have to keep in mind is that these kind of approximations only work if n is very, very large. All right. So they, in particular, they break down when n is short. So when n is short, you have to use a more accurate model. But for long n's, the freely jointed chain model usually works pretty well. And it's a bit simpler mathematically. Okay, let's see, where am I? Oh, where I am is disorganized. there was one other thing I wanted to say before I said this, so I'm going to rewind just a little bit. I just didn't look at my notes. In elastic materials, all right? So this is just of elastic materials. So suppose I have a square sheet of some elastic material. Just to make it easy to see, suppose I paint a dot on the center. And I stretch it. So it goes like this. And of course, the idea is that this thing that was a circle in the middle gets stretched into something like an ellipse. So This we call lambda 2, I think. This lambda 1. And what we assume is, what we're going to assume here is that the material deforms uniformly. So if it deforms uniformly, I can take a coordinate over here and map it to a coordinate over here by a simple, so I just say that I call this R prime, and I call this R. So R goes to R prime, all right? And what we assume here is that it's a linear transformation. We say that R prime, and I'm going to sort of confuse the notation a little bit. The deformation matrix I'm going to call E. All right, so this, I'll draw two wiggly lines under it, meaning that it's a tensor or a matrix. So this vector R prime is given by the deformation matrix times the original R. So I can relate this point to that point through this deformation matrix. Of course, you could also rewrite this as R alpha equals E alpha beta, R beta prime, alpha prime, just through the usual Einstein notation. What we're going to assume, and we'll come back to this a little bit later, is that you can define a free energy of the system that is the free energy per unit volume, all right? And so it's a free energy density. And that free energy density will be a function of the deformation matrix, all right? This makes sense in the sense that it takes, if I apply, say, a stress to stretch this material, I've done some work on it, and in particular, I've changed the free energy of this point because I've stretched it and maybe shrunk it a little bit. And so the free energy will be a function of this deformation matrix. If we want to get the total free energy of the system, we just integrate it over the entire volume, and that would give us the total free energy, at least the free energy change. Due to stretching it. All right, so that's just another definition I wanted to get out of the way. We'll use that a little bit later. Okay. Now, I said that the average of R squared is equal to N times B squared. There's another obvious thing that you've probably already figured out, which is the average of R itself in this model is equal to zero, right? There's no bias for it to go one way or another, so the average is zero. Now, we can get, what we want to get next is we want to get a probability distribution for R. All right, it's fairly easy because we know that R is the sum of B's. All right, and we have assumed that every B is independent of every other B. So what we have here is we have a random variable R that's the sum of a bunch of independent random variables, all right? And so we can invoke the central limit theorem. Which says that in the limit that n, the number of segments in this case, is much greater than 1, that this tends towards a Gaussian distribution. So if we just dealt with, say, not the whole R, but just with one component. Let's say we deal with the X component, all right? So we have that the total X displacement is the sum of all the, this would be the X component of the BNs, all right? And these are all independent again. So we can just write down from the central limit theorem that the probability of capital X is a random Gaussian variable, all right? That's what the central limit theorem tells us. It tells us that the distribution of capital X is Gaussian if X is a sum of independent variables and N is large. And it doesn't matter then what the distribution of the X of N are, all right? Independent of what their distribution is, a sum of a large number of them has to be Gaussian if N is very large. So what that means is you're going to get something that goes like this. So a Gaussian distribution will just be X minus the average value of X, all right, divided by 2 N times the variance of the distribution. And then, of course, if you want it so that when you integrate this over all X, you get unity. So if you do that, you have a normalization that's 1 over the square root of 2 pi N sigma squared. All right, so let's see. So here we have that the average of the B sub n's is equal to 0. And that means that the average of the X sub n's is equal to 0. So this term is 0. The other thing we know is that we have that bx squared plus by squared plus bz squared is equal to b squared. These three are all independent of each other, so their averages is just the sum of the averages. Since there's no difference between bx, by, and bz, it says that each of these, which I'll call b alpha squared, has to be 1/3 b squared, all right? So just a simple thing. So so with that, we can get the distribution function. Let me see where the eraser is. And so what we end up with is if you want this is all right, so here this is just b squared over. Well, here, let's do this a little bit differently. So this is like this. If I want to do P of R, all right. So P of R is just going to be P of X times P of Y times P of Z, since they're independent of each other. And so what you're going to get is you're going to get square root of 2 a, this will be cubed, and then you'll get e to the minus r squared over 2 and b squared over 3. All right, so if we write this out, then it's just going to be 3 over 2 pi n b squared to the 3 halves power times e to the minus 3 r squared over 2 n b squared. All right, so that's the distribution of the r vectors. So remember, r is our end to end length. And what it says is that it's Gaussian distributed, which of course means the most probable r is 0. Yeah, you had a question? Shouldn't what be 1? I can't hear you. Yes, it should be 1/3. Yeah, sorry. What?
X, Y, Z are independent.
Yeah, X, Y, Z are independent. Because it's a random direction, all right? So
all three can't be independent.
Yeah, they can. Well, oh, the, all three of them can't. The I see what you're saying. They have to add up to B. That's true. All right, I guess what you want to say is all three distributions have to be the same. You're right. So what you want to say is all three distributions have to be the same. So that's sufficient. So what I said was too severe. So all you need to use is the idea that all three have the same distribution, because just of isotropy. Okay. Now, so this is the thing we're after. You get a Gaussian distribution of the end-to-end lengths. Now, one thing that's interesting is we can get this distribution in a different way. That is, we would say that since this is a thermodynamic system, we'd expect that the probability of a certain end-to-end vector should be proportional to a Boltzmann factor, that is e to the minus u of r over kBt. And yet we have this over here. So what that suggests is it suggests that this quantity over here is equal to u of r over kT. All right, so we're going to write u of r is equal to 3 r squared over 2n b squared times kBt. All right, so this again comes back to this thing that I've emphasized several times, and that is in soft materials, most forces, most energies scale with kT. Yes? I'm sorry? There's no what? No, there's no, yeah, that's actually a good point. We're assuming no interactions between segments. that's actually a fairly strong assumption, and it's wrong in a lot of cases, all right? So what she said was, I'm assuming that there's no interaction between segments, all right? And that's absolutely true. I assume no interaction between segments. So let me say a couple of words about that. That actually came in sort of right at the beginning when I said that my polymer was going to be described by a random walk. In a random walk, some of the segments could lie right on top of each other. All right, and in principle, I should exclude those. All right. But it's really hard mathematically to exclude those. So as a first pass, you say, well, let's see how well we can do without excluding them. Now, I'll tell you a little bit about what the answers turn out to be. So it turns out that if you're in a polymer solution, particularly if the solvent is a good solvent for the polymer, so you have some solvent and the polymer just loves the solvent, which means that the segments want there to be solute molecules around it. In that case, this approximation fails. All right, and in that case, what you find is that this distribution is a bit expanded. That is, on average, the size of the polymer in a good solvent is a little bit better. It makes the distribution of end-to-end vectors, and matter of fact, makes the whole molecule a little bit bigger than this model predicts. All right. Now, there's sort of a cute thing you can do. Usually that happens, say, at high temperatures, say 80 degrees or something. If you start turning down the temperature, usually the quality of the solvent decreases. And in many cases, it decreases to the point at low temperatures where the polymer falls out of solution, in which case it's much smaller than this distribution would imply. All right. So in between there, somewhere, all right, is a temperature where this works perfectly, sort of by accident. All right. But polymer people love this temperature because the theories are simple there. All right. It's called the theta point. So if you hear people talking about polymer solutions and they talk about the theta point, it's the temperature where you get a Gaussian distribution, all right? So it's good at least one temperature, all right? Now, it's not as bad as that yet. If you go into a polymer melt, all right, so what we mean by polymer melt is there's no solvent around. There's just polymer molecules, but it's sufficiently warm that they don't solidify, that it's still a fluid. It turns out that that corresponds exactly to theta conditions. All right, you're in a polymer melt, you are quite naturally at the theta point. And so in a well-entangled, large molecular weight polymer melt, you actually get back to these conditions. All right, so the reasons for that take a fair bit of explaining, but the point I just want to make is that as severe as this approximation seems, it turns out to be not nearly as bad as you might think. And in fact, it turns out to be rather good. Okay? So that's a good point that you brought up. In a solvent, all right. Forget the high temperature just for a second. It will work in a good solvent. It won't work in a good solvent because it will swell a little bit bigger. So, for example, this relationship that I had, that R is equal to B times N to the 1/2. All right. It turns out that in a good solvent, the right answer is B times N to about the 0.6, all right? So you can see it's a little bit bigger. And by the way, the history of getting this exponent right is sort of interesting. So probably the most influential early worker, or theorist at least, in polymer science was Paul Florey, a chemist who was at a variety of places but ended up at Stanford. And he came up with an explanation for this and got the right answer through a sort of set of ingenious arguments. But when people looked at it closer, it turned out he was a little bit lucky because him getting the right answer had to do with making two mistakes which canceled out each other, all right? And so he got a better answer. The right answer, done the right way, was only obtained after the renormalization group was invented. And this is one of the first applications of it by Degen. So Pierre-Gilles Degen did a renormalization group, a proper calculation of this, and got essentially the right answer. All right. So, but it's a hard problem. It's not an easy problem. It's actually a historical note here. I'd always heard that result, but I never looked up the original paper. And maybe two or three years ago, I was looking through a journal and I saw this paper by Degen in early 1972. Like, it was published in January or February 1972. And that struck me as odd because the method he used an epsilon expansion. I know it was invented by Ken Wilson and Michael Fisher. And I seem to remember that they didn't publish the paper on that until late in 1972. So how was it that Degen was using the epsilon expansion in early 72 and even publishing a paper on it? And so at the end of the paper, Degen thanked Pierre Hohenberg, who's a colleague of mine. So I took this to Pierre and I go, what's going on here? Oh, by the way, the paper itself is one page long. He just says he uses the epsilon expansion method of Ken Wilson, and here's the answer, one page. There's not a whole lot. He doesn't fill you in on all the details of the calculation. So I asked Pierre, what's going on here? How can he publish this when it wasn't published until then? And he started thinking. He goes, there was this meeting in Moscow in late 1971. Where Ken Wilson gave a series of lectures on the renormalization group, and he handed out notes. And on the way back, I stopped in Paris, and I saw Degen, and Degen was really interested in this, and so I gave him the notes. And so he read it and did the calculation. And so that's how that happened. It's kind of an interesting story. But anyway, back to answering your question. Yeah, informal lecture. He handed out to his friends in Moscow. Things were pretty loose back then. And I think the renormalization group, I don't think anybody was going to claim they invented it. That was sufficiently difficult and profound that no one is going to take that away from Wilson. Any rate. All right, so in a good solvent, this is what you get. And it has to do with the fact that the polymer molecules have a strong preference to be nearer solvent molecules than nearer themselves. So when they come near each other, they repel each other. So generally speaking, there's not a hard and fast rule. As a matter of fact, you can find situations where it's exactly the opposite of what I'm saying. But generally speaking, when you cool a polymer solution, you have a phase diagram that, as a function of polymer concentration and temperature, looks like this. All right. So you're up here somewhere. All right. And you're cooling down. You're eventually going to hit this transition temperature. It's going to phase separate. All I was saying is, down here, just before it phase separates, it has to have shrunk to almost a tight ball because it's getting so it really doesn't like being near the solvent very much. And so all I'm saying is somewhere between here and here, it must have gone through exactly the right point. So say there, and that's the theta temperature, all right? So, so at that temperature, this works very well. It also works very well in polymer melts, all right? It's the starting place for most theories. Okay, so we have this relation. Of course, the force is just minus the gradient of this, and so the force is simply 3 kBT over 2 n b squared times r. All right, or minus if you want. Okay, so this essentially is a spring constant. So it's an entropic spring, all right? That is, all of this came from entropy. That is, these are all the configurations it can take on, and it tells you how likely they are. And and so the most likely position is having a end-to-end distance of zero. And then when you stretch it out from zero, it's going to cost you free energy. So if I grab on to both ends of a polymer and start stretching it, the force I'm going to have to apply will just be given by this this form of Hooke's law. All right. Now, one caveat here. Yes.
So, you know, how does this kind of spring definition differ from the elastic definitions in which there is you talked of before, the deformation kind
of thing? I'm sorry. Say it again. Yeah. Yes.
So, I mean, that kind of conventional spring thing, if I try to do something like that here, if I have a polymer of like.
Yeah, it's sort of interesting, isn't it? That is, here, when I double the length of the string, the spring gets weaker. That's absolutely right. I'll come back to that in just a second. All right. I think I can give you a halfway decent explanation of that. All right. But it does that's true. So while it behaves like a spring, it's not quite like the normal springs we're used to. All right. Oh no! Wait. That's true. Actually, you're right. Yeah, it's the other way. It's if you put them in parallel that you get twice. If you put them in series, you get twice. So it's the same. It's exactly the same. Actually, you're right. All right, actually, you're right. It's exactly the same. Okay, let's do something else. So one thing about this formula that you should know is that it fails for very large extensions, all right? You can see that immediately, because according to this, I can stretch it out till it's infinitely long, all right? There's no limit to how far I can stretch it here. If I apply a bigger force, it stretches more. And we know that the maximum stretch, R max, is just NB. It can't get longer than that, all right? So something's wrong with this formula. So people had thought about this for a long time, but where it really and people sort of knew this, and they even had some models of it, although they sharpened up their models when experiments came along. So sometime, I'm trying to remember exactly when it was, I would guess sometime around 1990. But don't quote me exactly on that. Steve Chu, who was then at Stanford, did a bunch of experiments where he took polymers and I'm trying to remember, I think he attached one end to a wall and he attached the other end to a colloid. It could be attached both ends to a colloid, I actually don't remember, but I think it was one end to a wall, one into a colloid, and then he put it in tweezers, and he pulled on it and measured the force. All right, he measured the force by seeing how much the particle displaced in the tweezer potential well. And so he could actually measure the force. And of course, what he found was that the force did increase linearly for small deformations with this spring constant. But as he stretched it more and more, the spring constant got bigger and bigger, all right, particularly as it approached that limit. So I'm not quite sure who did this analysis that I'm about. Yeah? I'm sorry?
There should be not these two in the
I'm sorry, I'm not hearing. What's your question? Oh, you're right. You're right. I should have taken out the two because I took the derivative with respect to R and the two came down. I just forgot that. Absolutely. Forgot the two. I don't know how to take derivatives. Yep, you're right. All right, so that's the spring constant. Somebody's paying attention. Good. All right, so there's another way of getting the force law that gives you it for all extensions. It's kind of clever. I think my friend Ron Larson came up with this. At least that's the that's where I know the derivation from. But I could be wrong. It could be that somebody else came up with this. It's kind of clever. So what he said is that the potential energy of a polymer is, of course, a function of all these BN vectors. Okay? And he said, well, that should just be equal to the work done. So it's minus the force times the distance stretched. And so he said, okay, so this is just minus the force, and the distance stretched is just the sum from n equals 1 to capital N of B sub n. Like that. So then you note that that the probability of getting some distribution of B sub n's is just going to be given by leave out the normalization constant, e to the minus u of all these BN's over KT. And that's equal to, I'll write it, this e to the minus beta, or beta is 1 over kt, times f, and there's another minus sign here, f dot, the summation n equals 1 to n of the b sub n's. All right, so I can rewrite this as a product now. All right, since I have this sum up here, I can just rewrite this as a product from n equals 1 to n of e to the beta. This is an f. Wait, yeah, that's f, sorry. E to the beta f dot b sub n. All right, so what I have is I have a product of this distribution times n times. All right, so since I have a product like that, it says that the BNs are all independently distributed, which actually we assumed they were from the beginning, so it's not too surprising. So this is just the probability distribution for the BNs. All right. So that means if I want to calculate an average BN, I can do so. I can say an average BN is just equal to integral over dB of B times the distribution function e to the beta f dot b. All right. Now I have to be careful here because what this is an integral over, it's the integral over all the directions that B can point. So I'll write here that B vector is constrained to be a constant. The absolute value of B is constrained to be a number, all right? And then, of course, I need to do the normalization. So the normalization is just the same integral. Without the B. All right, so these integrals are actually fairly easy to do if I make a coordinate system, and this is x, y, and z, and I make z along the direction that f points. All right, then I have my usual coordinates, all right, and this is my b vector points along this direction, all right? So I'm going to do the angular integral over all b directions. So for example, if I do the one on the bottom, this is just going to be the integral over phi from 0 to 2 pi, the integral over sine theta d theta from 0 to pi, and then e to the minus the magnitude of f, so I'll just write that as f without a vector sign, times v times cosine theta. All right. So the integral isn't too hard to do, mainly because this argument is, the differential of this argument is just this. All right. So with a little bit of work, you get out that this, well, actually, you can do the integral. In the interest of time, there's no point in me doing it. But it's as you can see, it's just a simple thing to do because of the exact differential of the argument. So when you calculate both of these integrals, what you end up with is you end up with the following formula, that the average of b sub n is equal to b. Now, the average of b sub n is going to be in the direction of the force. So this is just this is a unit vector in the direction of the force. All right, that's how I designate it. And then when you do those two integrals, you end up with the hyperbolic cotangent c minus 1 over c, where c is equal to beta times fb, or fb over kbt. All right, these are the magnitude of f and the magnitude of b there. All right, so that's what it is. Now, if you check, if you take the limit that the forces are small, all right, so and you do the expansion, okay, and that expansion, so in the limit that C is much less than 1, which is just small force, then hyperbolic cotangent of C is equal to, let's see, it's 1 over C and then plus C over 3, plus the next term is to minus C cubed over 45, dot, dot, dot. All right, so for small C, that's what a hyperbolic cotangent is. You see that this cancels out the first term, so your first term that survives is this C over 3. All right, so in that case, putting it together, your average R is equal to N times your average B, all right? And when you put that together and invert it, solve for R, which I won't do because it's just some simple algebra, what you end up getting is that this is equal to NB squared over 3 kBt times f. And if you invert that, you get that F is equal to 3kT over NB squared times R, all right, which is the same thing we got before with the two gone, all right? It didn't turn up there. So you get the right answer in that limit. On the other hand, if you do the other limit, where you say that the forces are very large, all right, so on the limit that C is much greater than 1, then you end up with, you can just read it off, R average is just going to be NB, all right, the N from this, and then this B, then the unit vector again, put that just to emphasize that, and then this term in the limit of large C, this is just 1. Hyperbolic cotangent goes to 1, so this is just 1 minus 1 over C. All right, so then with if you take C, remember that C is given by this with the FB over KT. I'm going to ignore the direction now. That's just a unit vector, so I'll ignore the direction and just say it's in the direction of the force. You solve this and you get that F is equal to KBT over B times 1 minus R over NB. All right, and so you can see this is nice because when R approaches NB, the force becomes infinite. All right, so it makes a lot of sense. Now, one thing that always bugged me, maybe it bugs you, maybe it doesn't. So, pardon? No, when R, so this is good for large, this is good for C very large, which means big forces, which. Oh, is it, do I have it upside down? Here's the problem. Thank you. I didn't read my notes. Yeah, this whole thing in the parentheses is to the minus 1 power. Thanks. All right, so one thing that always bugged me is that, people say, okay, this is an entropic spring. And I wonder, how does entropy produce a real force? All right, I have a rubber band, and this is what's going on inside of a rubber band. I stretch that thing, and it pulls back on me, all right? Where is that force coming from? There has to be some real physical force that's pulling on me. And while this gives you the right answer, I found it always a little bit bothersome that you could say entropy gives you a force. So here's the explanation I came up with for myself to make me a little bit happier, all right? And it's easy to see in the limit where you have it stretched all the way out. So suppose you have your polymer stretched all the way out. You're hanging on to it with, or almost all the way out, you're hanging on to it with a force. And then you push from the side. All right, if you push from the side, just push up, that's going to create tension in this and it's going to pull the two sides in. Right? So this is what's happening either in a polymer melt or in a polymer solution. That is, this thing is constantly being bombarded with by the molecules either in the solvent or from other polymers. It's constantly being bombarded by those things. And so that actually gives a force. If this thing's too long, those bombardments will actually pull on the strand and actually make it shorter. All right, so, and then it becomes also sort of apparent why KT appears. KT appears because the things that are beating on it, that's how much energy they have. They have KT of energy. And obviously, if you take their energy away, this force is going to go away. All right. So for me at least, once I understood that, I sort of became more accepting of this idea of the entropic force actually producing a real force. But it's not simply an argument about probabilities. That's part of it, of course. But it's this constant bombardment by a strand by the other molecules, or of a strand by the other molecules, does in terms of exerting a force along the backbone and on the ends. And so when it's all coiled up and these things beat on it, if it's too small, then all these forces beating on it will tend to make it bigger, just because this is where the entropy argument begins to make sense, because if they're beating on it, and they're beating on it randomly, their most likely effect that beating will more often send it to a state that's expanded than it will send it to a state that's contracted. All right, and it's whatever state it sends it to, it depends on what those forces are. And how specifically they're acting right now in time. But it's those forces, it's that bombardment of the strand by the other molecules that give it its force. If I take this strand and I stretch it all the way out and I stick it out in outer space, it's going to stay like that forever. It's not going to come back. There's nothing there to make it want to come back. And you can't use the entropy argument, all right, because there's no mechanism. It's nice, I think, to keep this in mind about what's going on and where this elasticity actually comes from. But it comes from the bombardment of the strand by its neighbors. Oh, okay. I'm taking a drink. My voice is still here. Good. My voice is better than we thought. We're going to go on for another hour. Not really. I'll start something. I'm not going to have time to finish it. But what I want to do is show you how these ideas can be translated into actually calculating the elastic modulus of something real. All right? And what we're going to do is we're going to calculate the elastic modulus of a piece of rubber. So this could be our rubber band.
Just a comment. I think in the earlier calculation you did not get this saturation. That's probably because you're using that Gaussian approximation. It's not really valid.
Yeah. So absolutely. So that's just another way of saying the same point, namely this Gaussian approximation is an approximation. It's only valid for fairly small extensions. But, for things in thermal equilibrium that aren't being pulled on, as long as the extension what I want to say is it works pretty well near equilibrium. And as a matter of fact, near equilibrium, you don't need to do anything. This will work just fine. It really only fails. Actually, maybe I can do this next time. I didn't plot it up, but it's interesting to plot up the whole solution with hyperbolic cotangent, and that'll be interesting because then we can see the domain of validity of this linear approximation. It's actually a bit farther than you might expect. In other words, you can calculate, you have this mean separation between the endpoints, all right, which that is the mean end-to-end distance. You might think that this approximation is only good if you stretch it twice that. My recollection is you can stretch it quite a bit beyond that and have it still work pretty well. But let's check this out. I don't.
If it's order root n, the square root of n.
So what that means, all right, but we can look at it quantitatively in from this expression, but what it means is you can stretch it out quite a bit, that is quite a bit beyond, I'm just trying to remember how it goes. We can deal with it. All right, I'll come back. We can do it. There's a simple modification you can make to take this. You can do the linear regime, and then you can take it a little bit. You can take it a little bit beyond the linear regime with a sort of a acute argument. All right, and you can develop a theory that's sort of a scaling theory. This is something that was due to Phil Pincus. So I'll show you how to do that. But actually, it works for calculations of systems in or near equilibrium, it works pretty well. You really do have to stretch it a fair bit, but we'll look at that. What I want to do is I'll tell you what the problem is, and I don't have time to set it up and do it. I'll do it on Saturday. Is what a rubber consists of is a rubber consists of a bunch of essentially a polymer melt. All right. By that I mean it's a liquid, or it would be a liquid, except for one thing. There are crosslinks in it. That is, there are places where polymers cross each other, and there's a chemical crosslink that keeps those, a covalent bond that keeps those together. So some of these might be accidental entanglements where the strands just cross near each other, and they're not cross-linked, but it has cross-links in it. And so what those cross-links mean is that what would have otherwise been a polymeric liquid now becomes a solid elastic material. All right. So what we're going to do is the following: we're going to use this picture we've developed with Gaussian distributions, and we're going to describe these strands between entanglement, or not between entanglement, between crosslinks with our theory here. All right? And we're going to use our theory to see what happens when we stretch it. All right? So imagine we take this whole network and we deform it. All right? So what we'll do is we'll use our theory to calculate the force, the restoring force, when you take it from its equilibrium state to some small deformation. All right, and from that we'll be able to get the elastic modulus. Now I'll show you just real quickly what the answer turns out to be, because it's a little bit interesting. The answer when you get all done is that the shear modulus turns out to be rho, the mass density of the rubber, times the gas constant, which I'll make capital G. That's, RG is Avogadro's number. Oops. Times KV. So it's rho times RG times T over the molecular weight of one of these sections, the average molecular weight of one of these sections. What's interesting about that is there's a number of things that are interesting about it, but you can compare that to the bulk modulus of an ideal gas. So the bulk modulus of an ideal gas, remember I defined that before, it's how the volume changes when you make a small change in pressure. You can calculate from the ideal gas law. It's actually n kBT, and if you reformulate it like this, it's the mass density times RG times T over the mass of a gas molecule. So what's interesting is when we're all done with this calculation we get an answer that looks like the bulk modulus for an ideal gas, but there's an important difference. In an ideal gas, the bulk modulus is small, all right? That is, you can compress it a lot because the density of the gas is small, all right? So that small density gives you a large compressibility. Here, the shear modulus in a cross-linked rubber is similarly small, but not because the density is small. The density is comparable to any liquid, normal liquid or solid. It's because the mass is big. That is, this mass is rather large. And you can see it's sort of interesting. I make this mass large by making the density of cross-links small. All right, so the smaller I make the density of cross-links, the longer it is between these, and the more I can stretch my stuff out. All right. And it, on the other hand, if I want a rubber that's very stiff, all I have to do is decrease the molecular weight of a segment here by putting in a lot of cross-links. So this is something that's used all the time. When people make rubbers, when they're made commercially, one of the principal ways in which they control their elasticity is simply by controlling the number of cross-links. There are other things they do too, like in your tires, they mix it with carbon black so that they wear better. But the first thing to be aware of is just this. But we can get this just using the simple Gaussian distribution theory that we developed, and you can show how you can sort of have a microscopic understanding of what the elastic properties are. So we'll do that. It'll take probably the first 15 minutes on Saturday, and then the other thing I'll talk about on Saturday is viscoelasticity in entangled polymer melts. All right, this is a cross-linked rubber. So what we'll do is ask what happens when you take away the cross-links. What does the rheology look like? It'll be a sketch. All right, because what we'll be doing is something called Doy-Edwards theory, and to understand it fully, I've taught it in graduate courses, and we take half a semester to do it. So it'll just be a sketch, but it'll give you some of the ideas of what we've learned over the past 30 years or so since it was developed. Okay, so that's it for today.